Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved.
Amen.
Amen. Holy One,
We confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you and our neighbor. Open our hands to serve you, your creation.
Amen.
Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen.
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 Forever.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
And I did not know that song. A little bit, maybe.
I love you. Love you.
Okay.
First reading, Zephaniah chapter 1, first chapter, verses 12 to 18. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice, he has consecrated his guests. At that time, I will serve Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the people who rest complacently on their graves, those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. Their wells shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste, though they build houses. They shall not inhabit them, though they land vineyards. They shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter, the very cryers out there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring such distress upon people that they shall walk like the blind. Because they have sinned against the Lord, their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. In the fire of his passion, the whole earth shall be consumed for a fool, a terrible, and he will make up all the inhabitants of the earth. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading, Thessalonians, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. Then they say, there is a peace and security. Then sudden disruption will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman. And there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in the darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you, you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night, and those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet the hope and salvation. For God has this us for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
On camera.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been entrustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Well, what we have here is a clear endorsement by Jesus of rapacious capitalism. Right? Jeff Bezos deserves everything he has and should get more. And all of those line workers who just take the money that they get for working in the factory and on the lines and just use it for things like, silly things like food and shelter and utility bills. We should take that from them and give it to Jeff Bezos also. Oh wait, that's the way capitalism actually works. Never mind, I'm mistaken, yeah. No, it's a bizarre parable. And we hear it in a funny way because we hear it in the context of our economic system, which didn't actually exist in the time of Jesus, capitalism, that is. And we hear a bunch of things, probably mishear a bunch of things in it, because as just one example, Jesus at one point encourages that he should have at least taken the 1 talent and invested it with the bankers and earned interest. But of course, all Jews, just like all Muslims yet today and many other religious denominations, believe you should never earn interest on any investments at all. That's actually sinful. So what's Jesus doing encouraging the 1 talent guy to invest in the banks? So there's all these kinds of funny things about this parable. But what I want to do in order to give better light to it, and I hope this is going to be helpful, is I want to back up and look at the Zephaniah passage that Reza read for us this morning. So Zephaniah, I know, is at the top of your list of repeat reads when you're opening the Bible, that you immediately go to Zephaniah and read it. Most of you probably have it memorized, but for those who don't have it memorized and weren't even sure Zephaniah was a book of the Bible until you heard it read this morning. Zephaniah is this late in the, you know, there's like the 12 minor prophets. They're minor only in the sense that each one of them wrote, or we collected only short sayings of them. The total amount of space that's taken up in the Bible by these 12 prophets is less than like just one prophet, like Isaiah or Jeremiah. And so they're minor in the sense of like space in scripture, but they're not minor in their spiritual insights at all, which is one of the reasons why they were ultimately collected here. So Zephaniah gets this kind of long introduction comparatively to the other minor prophets, and then he starts in on his word from the Lord, and the word from the Lord that comes from Zephaniah is somewhat unique. It starts, actually, and then continues in a way that's very, very global. So Zephaniah is probably like the closest thing to the Green New Deal prophet, right? Like the whole world is going to be, in fact, when you get to the end of Zephaniah, the whole world is going to be burnt up, consumed in a fire. And the warnings that come in Zephaniah are quite global in nature, and also very focused on creation. So it's more than just like interpersonal sin or injustice related to nations, but then the injustice that Zephaniah is seeing, that he's reporting on in this prophetic book, then impacts like the way that God judges it is God judges the whole world, including creation itself. So you get this passage that opens kind of the book. It's early in Zephaniah, and the warning that Zephaniah gives is against those who rest complacently on their dregs. Those who say in the hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do harm. When I read this, I can't help but think of that great prophet of the 21st century who stood in front of the leaders of the world and screamed at them, "How dare you?" You remember Greta Thunberg's words to those organized to talk about climate change on the planet. There is this kind of general philosophy that it's the operative philosophy of much of the world that the Lord will do neither harm nor good. We can just kind of go ahead and proceed with what we're doing. And there will be debates on both sides. You might end up with some people denying climate change and saying, actually, it's going to be another ice age, and humans can't affect the actual global climate. And then you have other people who think, like, in 20 years, the whole world is going to be consumed in some kind of heat wave that will destroy everything. But the way we operate in most of our personal lives and globally is as if neither harm nor foul will happen. It's just kind of going to keep going along. And so that's the kind of warning that Zephaniah is raising. Watch out to those of you who think that God's going to do neither harm nor good. That's the warning. And then it's a warning to anyone who's gotten comfortable with what they have. So their wealth shall be plundered and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. I'm reminded of the way my first visit, actually, to Northwest Arkansas included a drive from the airport to Fayetteville. And those of you who lived in Fayetteville post-2008 with the housing market crash and saw what happened, remember all those developers had gotten started on all of those properties out kind of on farmland between here and the airport. And so when I was driving in from the airport, I went past the, you know how developers like to build those walls that say, say, hey, this is going to be a development. We're going to build houses in here. Well, they built the walls, and they built the spec house out front, and then they went bankrupt. Or whatever happened. I'm not sure what happened. Maybe they just didn't have a market for the houses. And so anyway, you ended up with all of these spaces that had been intended for homes that now no one was living in. And so the warning here is that can happen, and that can happen at any time. And of course, Israel and Judah know this to be the case. Even if you built like a large mansion and got super, super comfortable, even if you were a billionaire and had all of this wealth, the world historically knows that how easily that kind of comfort can be devoured. You know, you can be a billionaire, and if inflation happens and the billion becomes worth a dollar, suddenly your billionaire status is undermined. Or if you're comfortable in your home and your safe nation and you're invaded by a foreign army, no amount of wealth necessarily will protect you. And so this is the actual experience that the Israelites and Judah had during this period was when the prophet gets to the great day of the Lord is near and hastening fast. The day of the Lord is bitter. The warrior cries aloud there. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. Zephaniah isn't necessarily describing like what's going to happen at some future date, but actually is describing what they're actually experiencing right then. It's imminent or even has already happened. And interestingly for Zephaniah, compared to maybe some of the other prophets, his word is spoken not just for Israel and Judah, but for everyone. So by the end, you get, for a full and terrible end, he will make them all inhabitants of the earth. This is echoed, interestingly, in the New Testament as well. You get, like, for example, in Romans, the statement from Paul that it's not just that God will put some under condemnation, the especially abject sinners, but what Paul says in Romans is that God has brought all under condemnation so that he might have mercy on all. So there's this totality that's articulated in Zephaniah that then gets brought forward into much of the rest of Scripture, especially into the New Testament theology of how to think about the consequences of sin. So that's the word, that's the prophetic word, and the warning from Zephaniah, along with a lot of the rest of the prophets, has to do with, it's not supposed to be a prediction of the future, it's supposed to be a reminder of what those who are listening ought to be focused on now. This is really important, so I'll kind of say this again. We tend to think, because this is the popular idea, that prophets are predicting the future. But that's not prophecy. That's like Nostradamus type, like, there's another word for that, which I'm drawing a blank on right now, but it's magic, right? Like predicting the future. Oculomancy? Is that what you call it? Anyway, somebody's going to Google it later and post it in the thread so you can help me remember what the actual word for that is. But prophecy, according to Scripture, is not exactly predicting the future. What prophecy is it's an articulation of, or a reminder of, God's will for justice now. That's what a prophet is. Prophets speak out against injustice. It's that simple. And so when you have the prophet like Zephaniah, or many of the other prophets, whether that's Amos, or Habakkuk, or Micah, or any of these minor prophetic texts, what you get is you get words from the prophets saying, thus says the Lord, and then things like, I despise your festivals, because you have neglected the weightier matters of justice. You've neglected caring for the widow and the orphan and the poor, etc. Okay, why does this matter for understanding the text here in Matthew? The reason it matters has to do with the content or the how we understand the investment that these three who have been loaned talents from their master, like where they invest it, right? So what Jesus says, and interestingly, this is not one of those Kingdom of God parables. So this is not what the Kingdom of God is like. This is just another, this is a Jesus story. It's as if, I'm telling you this interesting story, it's as if, you know, and then lays it out. So you got all these slaves, they get loaned all these talents, they're loaned absurd amounts of money. Five talents is like five lifetimes worth of income. So, I don't know, maybe the average middle class person might make a couple million in their life if they're doing really well. So you're loaned $10 million. And you're supposed to hold on to it until the master comes back. Or $4 million, or $2 million until the master comes back. And then when the master comes back, each one of them reports on what they did. And when we hear this investment part, look, hey, look, I took $5 million, and I invested it, and I'm back, coming back to you with $10 million. Because we live in like capitalist society central, and every one of our phones, when we go into our phone and go to the news section, immediately takes us to reports of the Dow and the NASDAQ every day, we assume immediately that what the hearers of this gospel would have understood as being the investment strategy was, obviously, the stock market, right? That's where you really make bank, especially if you have enough money to put it into like a some kind of aggressive fund, a hedge fund, whatever those are. That's where you get to, I think a hedge fund is actually where you get to invest money you don't even have and pretend as if you had it, and then if you make money, then you make money on money you never had. I think that's actually what a hedge fund is, right? It's the most ridiculous thing we've maybe ever created in our culture. It's just a vehicle for rich people to get more rich. That's what it is. Okay, so this here, you have this investment of these talents, and you think, okay, it must be like, there must be some kind of stock market that these slaves could invest in, and that's what they're doing. But for one, there wasn't one in that day. So it couldn't have been that. And so then you get to ask yourself, like, well, what were these investments in? Huh. And how do you figure that out? Well, one way you can figure it out is you can get out a Bible and you can look at Matthew 25, 14 through 30. You could be like, huh, what comes right after this passage? Verses 14 through 30. What's the next story? Do you think it's possible that Jesus set these listeners up to get in their imagination that they should invest well? And is it possible that he even then told them a story next that told them how they ought to invest their money? Is that even a possibility? So, hey, let's look. The judgment of the nations. Verse 31. All the nations are going to get gathered together for judgment. Does that sound like the prophets in Zephaniah? A little bit, right? Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. How did you invest your five talents? I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we did all of these things? And whenever you did it to the least of these, you did it to to me. Enter into the joy of your master. How did the 5-talent person invest their money in such a way that they ended up with 10 talents? They gave it to people so they could buy food and clothes and get shelter. They spent it on people who were in jail. They spent it on welcoming strangers. And one, the one who gets booted out, thought to himself, you know, this master I know is a harsh master. Doesn't like it at all if I gave money to somebody and they bought cigarettes or bought dog food with it, wasted it in some way. So I better just hold on to it, bury it in the ground, and give it back when the master returns. And then you get the warning. We're not going to go too far into this because I have to preach on this passage again next week. Jesus tells this parable so that our understanding of what it means to invest and earn might be completely flipped. You want to know how to make a lot of money? You want to know how to make a bank? You want to know what stock market is constantly going up and never drops? You want a sure thing? Then you can either go with Bernie Madoff. Oh, whoops, he's in jail. Okay, wait. So not Bernie. Is that his name? Or you can give it away. Water to somebody who's thirsty, food to somebody who's hungry, shelter to somebody who needs it. You could even visit Bernie Madoff in jail. Enter into the joy of your master. Amen.
Weak made strong in the Savior's love.
through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come, when the trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, call us to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Lord of the church, ignite your people with the passion of your love. By the power of your Holy Spirit, unify us across ministries, congregations, and denominations, and refine us to participate in your activity throughout the world.
Amen.
Lord of creation, we stand in awe at the works of your hands and praise you for the beauty of nature. Mm. Bless the earth for your glory and restore its integrity where exploitation has caused ruin. Lord of the nations, sound forth your justice in the ears of all leaders. Increase concern for those who are most vulnerable, especially as international leaders forge trade agreements and cooperate to end human rights abuses. Lord of all in need, search out all who cry to you in distress. Scatter the heavy clouds of depression, chronic illness, unemployment, and loneliness with your radiant light. Send us as encouragement signs of your healing. Lord of the stranger, stir up holy restlessness in us to extend love to those at the margins. Release our desire for control and open us to learn from the perspectives of others. Lord of the living and the dead, we give you thanks for all the saints at rest from their labors. Rouse us to live by their example, that saints yet to come may also know your love. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also
with you.
Please take some time to share that peace with one another. Air hugs, elbow bump, fist bump. There's a link in your bulletin to resources for online giving. It's especially helpful if you use our online resource to set up automated giving, so we have that reliable weekly or monthly donation. And then I'll just quick run through a couple of announcements here for those who came into the service midway. This Wednesday, we're giving out Advent boxes to families and children. If you haven't already signed up for that through me, drop me a note and we can get you connected. Next Sunday, the 22nd, we have our Thanksgiving carryout at 5 p.m. And there's a Facebook event you can share around and come by and grab some food. Today at 11 a.m., we have our congregational meeting. to approve our budget for 2021. So we invite you to join us for that meeting. The rest of the announcements you can read in the bulletin, and we continue with the great Thanksgiving.
And also with you,
lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. For on this day, overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. So in the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
On the night before he died, Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We pray in the words that our Lord has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ shed for you.
Amen. Body of Christ broken for you.
Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God. Yeah.
Prepared in the sight of everyone, a light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled.
You let your servant go in peace.
Your word has been fulfilled. As I've seen salvation you have prepared in the sight of everyone,
a light
to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people Israel.
Will you let your servant go in peace?
Your word has been fulfilled.